Hello everyone, welcome back to a new module of research methodology, that is quantitative research. As of now, we have done various modules on research methodology, but whenever we talk about research, this is one thing that comes to our mind is quantitative research and qualitative research. Today, I, Dr. Ritu Sharma, would be dealing with this quantitative research module with you under the MOOCs program. So, while dealing with the quantitative module, we will be discussing an overview of the characteristics of quantitative research. We'll be investigating the different stages of the research processes in experimental and sample survey methods. Then we'll examine the process for drawing on accurate and representative sample at the population. Then we'll provide an appraisal of the different questions type, measures and indicators which are used in designing the questionnaire. Finally, we'll highlight the main issues confronting social researchers when using quantitative approach and methods in the research projects. The term quantitative method refers in large part of the adoption of the natural sciences experiment as the model for scientific research. Its key feature being quantitative measurement of the phenomena studied and systematically control of the theoretical variables influencing those phenomena. Thus, the logic of such research is to first collect data using standardized approaches on a range of variables. Second, search for patterns of causal relationship between these variables. And third, test given theory by confirming or denying the precise hypothesis. The method employed in this type of quantitative social research are most typically the sample survey and the experimental method, a method that is particularly popular in social sciences research. The sample survey is the most commonly used technique for gathering information, whether by quantitative or qualitative. Surveys are based on using statistical sampling method by taking a representative sample from a given population and applying a standard research instrument in the form of a structured questionnaire. Surveys enable descriptive and explanatory generalization to be made about the population in question. Quantitative approach differ from qualitative approach in a number of ways, and most importantly, there is a relatively high degree of preconceptualization associated with quantitative based research. Adapting the theory then research approach, researcher working within this tradition will have certain a priori assumption about exactly what research questions to address and how these should be formulated. How the study should be designed, including which research tools to use, how data is collected, and how it is organized, and the intended methods of analysis, the range of likely findings to be expected. This approach contrasts sharply with qualitative approach, which, as we have seen, are typically involved in exploratory research, in which the objective is to open up a research question. Here, the research strategy is guided by the reality of conducting a research project. Decisions about how a qualitative-based research study is to progress often takes place during the course of the research itself rather than before it has begun. In this module, we'll try to understand use of both experiment and sample surveys, some of their advantage and disadvantage, the issues that arise by their use. Design issues and techniques in experiments and sample survey will be reviewed, like types of method use, differing sampling strategies, and so on, together with an overview of the debate concerning the legitimacy of these quantitative methods within the social sciences. Experimental research. Experiments are most commonly used in psychological research and in the broad field of business studies, particularly in organizational research. Experimental research is based on researcher manipulating certain controlled conditions in order to identify the relationship between particular variables that it is hoped will explain cause and effect relationship. In seeking to measure the impact that one factor has on another by controlling all the other factors that might have an effect, experimental research builds on the principle of a positivist approach to science more than any other research techniques. Experiments can be carried out in either a laboratory or a field setting. Laboratory experimentation is most closely regulated method of experiment. involving the introduction of certain conditions into a controlled environment that stimulates key characteristic of a natural environment. An example might be to examining the extent to which the responses of a group of voters to question about political attitude after exposure to a series of party election broadcast might be different from another yet identical group's response when it has not been confronted with such images. Such experiments allow for very considerable control on behalf of the researcher who is able to effect change and observe research participants' subsequent behavior. Experiments conducted outside the laboratory take place in a natural environment under as careful controlled condition as possible. An example might be a situation in which researcher stage a physical attack in a public place to examine people's response to the incident as an investigation of a bystander apathy. Field experiments are somewhat different. Here, experiment principles are applied to live social events and therefore permits the study of phenomena which ethical or practical consideration would normally rule out. Essentially, the researcher measures the effect of an intervention which is occurring naturally. Such projects which measure variables without manipulating them are often called quasi-experiment or non-experimental designs. An example might be a comparison of voter turnout for local election in two different areas, one where a new initiative has been introduced by a local authority, voting by telephone, and one where it has not. The role of the researcher will be to measure any change in the voting levels that allow from the initiative to examine whether there is a cause and effect relationship between the two variables, which is in that case are voting methods and voter turnout rate. Establishing causality. Experimental research is based on testing a hypothesis stating a relationship between a dependable variable and an independent variable. A dependable variable is the variable that the researcher wishes to explain, and an independent variable is the variable that researcher expects to explain the change in the dependable variable. If we can determine that the two variables or phenomena vary, then we can say that we have established a covariation. For example, we may be able to establish covariation between personal income and political conservatism. However, simply being able to say that a change in the level of income is associated with the change in conservatism is rather limited in terms of scientific explanation. In the majority of cases, researcher will want to go beyond covariation to demonstrate causality, that a change in the independent variable causes a change in the dependent variable. To be able to establish causality, it must be possible to establish the time order of event that the effect follows the cause. In the natural sciences, where experiments are carried out under highly controlled conditions, the verification of causality is not particularly problematic. For example, it is relatively straightforward to determine that the application of heat to water causes it to boil. However, in the social world, we are often faced with co-varying relationships where causality is far from clear-cut. To return to our example of income and political conservatism, it is possible to argue that either of the variable may cause the other. As person's income increases, they become more conservative in both outlook and behavior. If a person adopts conservative values and lifestyle, they are likely to see an increase in their income. The chain of causality in the example is difficult to establish, even though covariation is relatively easy to identify. Even where we can demonstrate a clear covariation between two variables and we are capable of asserting that one predates the other, we do not necessarily have sufficient condition in which to infer causality. Other variables must first be ruled out for this to be the case. For example, it would be a weak explanation of the relationship between these two phenomena that did not take into account age, It may be that a person's age is a major determinant factor in relation to both people's political view and the level of personal income that they are able to earn. Where a causal relationship between two variables could possibly be explained by a third variable, we can say that the relationship is a spurious one. Thus, researcher seeks to establish non-spuriousness, that causality is not violated by the existence of another variable. The steps to be taken when conducting an experiment are: 1. Determine the dependent variable and independent variable in your research. Choose the level of treatment to be adapted, that is, what test to be used and how often it is to be conducted. Then 3, draw a representative sample from your target population. 4, impose as many controls as are possible on other parameters that could affect the conditions of the experiment. Divide the research participants into an experimental group and a controlled group. Protest both the experimental group and the control group using an appropriate instrument. Expose the experimental group to the treatment. Measure both the experimental and control group again using the same instrument. Collect data from both the pre-testing and post-testing of both groups. Analyze data to determine the effects of the treatment on the experimental group. Now, let's discuss the issues in conducting the experimental research. All experiments are subject to threat to their validity in ways that may severely detract from their findings. These are expressed in terms of threats to an experiment's internal validity, that is, those things that may affect whether a true measurement has been obtained using the measuring instrument, and threats to external validity, that is, concerning the generalizability of the findings to the intended population. Internal validity: history events that may occur in society between the first and the second measurements which could explain the change in the dependable variable. For example, in carrying out an experiment on workplace morals, something may happen in the experimental group's workplace and not in control group's workplace. Even outside influence such as particular good or bad weather, most definitely outside the control of the experimental, may have impact on the experiment. The next point that needs to be taken care of is the maturation. Other processes that may be influenced by the passage of time between the two tests, the obviously dependent on the time that elapsed between the pre-test and the post-test. Where the gap is a considerable one, a variety of factors including personal life events may need to be taken into account. 3 is the mortality. This happens when some of the experimental or control group leave the experiment, thus affecting the two groups' comparability. Again, this will be a function of length of the experiment and will be more of an issue where the experiment takes place over a longer period. 4th one is the instrumentation. Any variation in the tests, whether between the two groups or over the two tests, it will be very important to ensure that the same instrument is used for both the pre-test and the post-test. If this is not the case, then the observed difference could be the result of variation in a measurement process. Testing, the final point, the possibility that the test itself may explain the change in the dependable variability. For example, in the course of carrying out an experiment on the extent to which exposure to a party election broadcast might affect the level of people's political knowledge, the very act of actually taking part in the experiment itself might affect people's test score. It might get them into the mode of being tested, perhaps by relieving any pre-test nerve and increasing their general pre-test level of confidence. If this is the case, it is possible that any change you record may actually be the result of your conducting the research, not of showing them the party election broadcast. Next is external validity. The main threat to external validity is that the knowledge that people are participating in a study is likely to impact on the behavior of the research participants. If, for example, the people in the study know that you are observing them to see whether their morale has improved after the introduction of a new management initiative, they may deliberately act in a particular way. This is known as the problem of reactivity. They may display marked positive or negative reaction depending on the disposition towards their employer. This phenomenon has become known as the Hawthorne effect. After a research project that was carried out by Hawthorne Works in Chicago in the 1920s, where the workers in question acted up for the benefit of the researcher. Reactivity is used as a methodological justification for using a level of deception in experimental research. Ethical issues in the experimental research. Experimental research raises a number of ethical dilemmas concerning the manner in which researchers treat people. For example, some researchers may consider it inappropriate to manipulate human beings in the same way as laboratory animals such as mice and guinea pigs are treated. An additional ethical consideration in relation to experimental research is the question of including or excluding people from a study in which some may benefit. For example, an experiment may be designed to measure the effect that the introduction of CCTV has in reducing crime in certain residential neighborhoods. In this instance, it may be argued that researchers occupy a too powerful position in being able to decide which area and therefore which residents will benefit from the experiment and which will not benefit. One way around such a charge of unethical abuse of power by the researcher is to take a chain that is occurring anyway and collect or obtain statistics from before the change, during it and after it. This is known as quasi-experiment. As we have discussed earlier, there are two types of quantitative research, experimental method and survey method. We have already seen the experimental method. Now we are going to discuss the survey method. We have already discussed sample survey in detail in another module on survey method and sampling method. We'll try to understand very briefly here. Sample surveys are conducted in order to provide the researcher or the sponsor of the research with statistical information either on a particular issue or a problem that needs resolving or to test the robustness or not of an existing theory. This involves measuring various phenomena and drawing conclusion about any relationship between them to establish patterns of cause and effect. For instance, in a study of industrial relations, we might compare different workplaces in terms of a number of variables that we hypothesize are likely to be associated with the industrial descent. These might be the size of the firm or organization, the type of industry, the inclusiveness of the decision-making process, whether the organization is unionized or not, the skill level of the employees, the gender mixing within the organization, the balance between part-time and the full-time employees, the unemployment rate in the local area, and so on. To analyze such relationship and draw widespread conclusion requires the researcher to generate large amount of data so that conclusions can be generalized from the sample survey to the wider population from which the survey respondents were drawn. In order to have confidence in the results generated from a sample survey and to eliminate or minimize bias, the researcher should aim to maximize the response rate and in doing so ensure that the study is representative of the population group. Sample surveys are a method of gathering information by means of personal interviews or questionnaire. They are sometimes referred as mass interviews because they are a way of collecting similar information from a large number of people at the same time. Sample surveys are based on standardized approaches using standardized instruments such as questionnaire. These research instruments employ fixed question and answer formats so that there is a consistency of data collection approach, regardless of who is actually asking the question. The sample survey is therefore akin to a structured dialogue between usually two people in which the researcher asks a series of pre-planned standardized questions and the respondent's answer are recorded precisely on a form and ultimately turned into numbers for statistical analysis. In this way, the studies are said to be quantitative in nature. Let's now understand the uses of the survey research, which is a very important part of the quantitative research. Academic researchers conduct surveys to test out various research hypotheses. For example, they may want to explore the relationship between age and political convertism, or why is it that some children play truants from school, or under what circumstances people become addicted to gambling. By gathering statistical evidences, survey research may help to support a particular theory by shedding light on the connection and association that exists between such variables. In this way, researchers look for patterns that may explain social phenomena. Academics are not the only people who use survey method as research method. Other users of surveys can be broadly categorized as follows. One, government and its agencies, volunteer sectors, organization, and campaign groups use survey research to inform the influence of the political, economic, and social policy making process. Then business of all sizes carry out surveys in their quest for gathering a lead in the market for their product by differentiating their product against those of their competitors. Third, the media and the political parties carry out public opinion polls on voting intentions, partly political leaders and their policies. Survey research can be used to obtain multifaceted data from an individual on the behavior. Straightforward questions on what the respondent has done or is doing or may be doing in the future. For example, it is possible to ask people if they use public transport for certain journeys or if they are vegetarian. Then there are questions on belief, like what people think will happen. What do they believe is true or false? Do people believe that the National Health Service is safer in the hands of the current government than it was under the previous administration? Then there are questions on attitudes, how people think and feel about certain things. For example, whether people consider that women with preschool children should participate in the workforce. Questions on attributes. These are the personal questions that concern the characteristics of the respondent, such as his or her age, sex, ethnicity, religion, and employment status. As such, these questions have the potential to be viewed as a sensitive question. They are often referred to as classification questions. By employing a combination of such questions in a survey, the skillful researchers open up the possibility of describing and explaining complex social phenomena. Now, let's understand the method of data collection in a quantitative research. There are four main types of data collection method for a social survey. First one, the face-to-face interview, where the respondent is questioned in person by an interviewer. The main advantage of this method is that it usually results in a relatively high response rate. Second, however, such interview commonly incurs high costs due to the number of interviewers that need to be employed, and it is also argued that the personal interaction between the interviewer and the respondent can lead to a biased response. Then, in a study that considers questions of child discipline and punishment, it may be that respondent will offer the socially acceptable response, the answer that they believe the interviewer wants to hear. Second is the postal questionnaire. Postal questionnaires are widely used because they are relatively cheap to administer and they enable coverage of a wide geographical area. Also, given that they avoid direct personal contact, they have the advantage at assuring a degree of privacy for the respondent. The main disadvantage associated with the postal questionnaire is that they perform poorly in relation to response rate. Telephonic interview. They have become more common in the past decades as technologically advances have allowed researchers to draw samples with great accuracy. They are very quick to administer, however, they are limited to researchers who have access to the relevant technology such as random digital dialing technology to carry them out. Online surveys, which are delivered by email or make use of a web-based form in place of a questionnaire, are now widely used. They share some of the characteristics of postal surveys in that they are inexpensive to administer but may have lower response rate than interview administrative surveys. access to data, the instant response is sent, and being able to draw samples on a global scale are also attractive benefits. But the difference between the characteristic as internet users and non-user can result in internet-based samples which are not representative at the general population. Once the data have been collected, the researcher have to codify and process the data in a manner that it becomes presentable in tabular form and charts. It should also become accessible for use for statistical treatment that would tell us about the different qualities of data. Each of these methods of data collection has its own strength and weaknesses in relation to design, cost, and so on. And in crude terms, one's weakness are often the other's strength. The method that is selected will depend on the type of population you aim to research, the nature of research question, and the resources at your disposal. Sampling. A very important part of survey method is sampling. Surveys are often referred to as sample surveys because the information that the researcher wishes to gather is usually collected from a selected group of people, a sample. It is very unusual for researchers to question all of the people that they wish to study owing to both times and cost considerations. Sampling has been dealt as a separate module. Here we will have a basic idea about the sampling survey. Sampling is a method that identifies a representative number from a given universe population. There are two basic properties of sample. It should be adequate and it should be representative of the universe. The most crucial point in sampling is to make sure that one's personal values do not influence the selection process. In order to keep out the researcher's bias, various techniques or procedures of selecting a sample have been suggested. To take an often used analogy, one does not need to eat an entire fruit cake to gain an idea of its taste. A single slice will do that. Although the larger the slice, the better it is. The same is the case with the sampling method. The researcher will not need to include all members of the target group of his or her study. A subset will do, providing it has been selected carefully. However, the usual rule is that the larger the subset selected, the higher the level of accuracy to be expected in the findings from the sample survey. Thus, in survey sampling, the margin of difference between the results from the sample and the population values referred to as a sampling error is attributed primarily to the method of sample selection and secondly, the size of the sample. Method of sample selection. As we have already discussed sampling method, here I am just going to tell you the names of various sampling methods or techniques. The details of it can be studied in the module on sampling methods. First, probability sampling method. Second, simple random sampling method. Third is systematic sampling. Fourth is stratified random sampling method. Then in non-probability sampling methods, we have quota sampling, convenience sampling, and snowball sampling. The next process of survey research is the design of questionnaire. A good questionnaire should include a mix of closed, open, and scaled questions. Furthermore, it will take into account the type of data to be collected and the resources, time and money that are available for the study. A good question is also one in which the questions that have been asked are well crafted and are the product of careful considerations. In designing the questionnaire, researchers should do their utmost to avoid the many pitfalls that present themselves, including the use of ambiguous language, a language that is not appropriate for the targeted audience, a prejudiced language, questions which lead respondent to answer in the way that could result in biased data. Of equal importance is the need to structure the questionnaire so that it aids the progression of the interview. Asking the question in a relatively logical order enables sensible flow to develop. It should also be borne in mind that overly lengthy questionnaires are likely to put many people off from the participating in a study. It is important, therefore, to be concise and economic, and the subject areas in a survey as well as the language used in the actual questions. Issues in conducting sample surveys. While the sample survey is the most commonly used research method within the social sciences, it has been criticized on a number of levels. The first one, the logic of the sample survey. Critics argue that the logic of sample survey in attempting to isolate causal explanation between different variables is in itself deficient. Given the complexity of human consciousness and behavior, critics hold that survey researchers will not be able to gain access to the process through which people adopt particular views or act in particular ways by simply posing a series of highly structured questionnaire. Thus, collecting numerous items of information about the world of, for example, industrial relations and subjecting these to various statistical tests in order to identify which variable appears to have the highest degree of association with the key variable, industrial descent, fails to uncover. The history of industrial relation in a particular organization, what the working conditions are likely for employees, and how these experiences may have shaped the outlook and attitude of employees to new work practices that are being introduced by the management of the organization. It may be that it is these very processes that have had the most significant effect on the industrial relation within an organization, but they may not be revealed in a questionnaire survey that actively avoids two-way dialogue. Second point is the value content of the surveys. Another major criticism leveled at survey research is that far from being an objective method for dispassionately collecting social fact, it employs techniques which both reflect and reproduce assumption that the researcher hold about the social world and in particular the phenomena under investigation. Thus, the structured format of the questionnaire-based study suggests that the researcher has made certain choices about the overall research design, the issues which should and by implication should not be raised, and the format of the model of delivery, self-completion forms or interviews. In this way, critics of the sample survey claim that the study and its conclusion is largely a function of the value and presupposition of the researcher. Those who criticize survey from this perspective may advocate that the use of qualitative research as an alternative in that such method are more likely to let the respondents speak for themselves. Then there is a lack of depth of context. Furthermore, because the question and answer system employed are highly structured, respondents are denied the opportunity to elaborate on issues, especially those of a complex nature, or to qualify the answer given. Thus, critics would claim that this failure to gain an holistic appreciation of a respondent's view concerning an issue or phenomenon inevitably results in only partial data and fails to tap into the reality which exists within the inner consciousness of the respondent. The understanding and interpretation of questions. At an epistemological level, the highly structured approach employed in a questionnaire-based studies undermines a researcher's ability to ensure that the respondent's understanding and interpretation of the questionnaire is as intended by the researcher. Obviously, if there is no correspondence between the researcher and the respondent in terms of the meaning given to the questions posed, the research will be invalidated. Finally, conducting online surveys. There are number of immediate advantages to adopting web-based surveys over postal surveys, perhaps the most obvious of which is the automation of the data collection. As soon as the respondent submit their answer, the data are ready to be analyzed. This saves time and money, but also enables sample characteristics to be monitored as responses are received in real time. Every speculative analysis may also be carried out. Completing an online form does, however, requires a certain amount of technical proficiency, which might impact upon a respondent's ability of willingness to participate. Some researchers highlight the lack of conclusive evidence on studies which have attempted to compare the response rate of online and traditional surveys, but others say that online survey produce more complete data and fewer dropouts and claim to be contradicts previous evidence to the contrary. Whether online surveys do indeed produce better response rate is difficult to gauge, but it would seem that all the standard issues already addressed in relation to respondent race, such as questionnaire design, salience of the topic, and sending of reminder letters, hold on hold for online survey as well. In summary, online survey provide useful means of generating a large amount of data at relative little cost, but special attention must be paid to the design of online forms and potential bias in samples. That said, online research does, through special discussion forum and social networking sites, open up an opportunity to access global samples large enough for meaningful analysis, which might not otherwise be possible. Coming to the last type of survey method is political opinion polls. Opinion polls are the form of a social survey. They differ only in terms of the subject areas upon which they focus. While social surveys are concerned with issues which might broadly be defined as social polls, investigating people's political beliefs, attitudes, opinions, and behavior. In terms of the method employed and general approach followed, opinion polls and social surveys are broadly identical. Generally, the performance of opinion polls in forecasting the share of voters achieved by the different political parties general election is considered to be good. Finally, I would like to conclude by saying that in this module, we have discussed all main quantitative methods that are used in research, sample survey and experiment. In particular, we have considered the usefulness and application at sample survey research. We have seen that the logic of the quantitative research is to explain social phenomena, why people behave in the way they do or hold certain views and values by reference to underlying causes. This emphasis on the search for causal connections between different phenomena or variables tend to steer researchers working within this tradition towards favoring highly structured research approach and techniques such as experiments and questionnaire-based sample survey. Quantitative approach, while comparatively dominant within the social sciences, have attracted significant criticism at both epistemological and technical level. Largely, this criticism is leveled at the very structured nature of such method, which is claimed to prevent any opportunity for respondent to seek clarification over the meanings of question that are asked and in turn to communicate their responses fully and clearly. This is said to threaten seriously the validity of any such research project. Such critics would therefore dispute the extent to which survey research can provide an accurate assessment of people's view and behavior. Hope now both the method, that is quantitative method and qualitative method, are clear to you and you can go for your research. And if you have any doubts, you can always write us back and get your doubts clear. Thank you so much.